The Gospel according to Luke chapter 20.
Glory be to you, O Lord.
Jesus' parable about the vineyard is also the text for our sermon today. Jesus went on to tell the people this parable. A man planted a vineyard, rented it to some farmers, and went away for a long time. At harvest time, he sent a servant to the tenants so they would give him some of the fruit of the vineyard. But the tenants beat him and sent him away empty-handed. He sent another servant, but that one they also beat and treated shamefully and sent away empty-handed. He sent still a third, and they wounded him and threw him out. Then the owner of the vineyard said, "What shall I do? I will send my son, whom I love. Perhaps they will respect him." But when the tenants saw him, they talked the matter over. "This is the heir," they said. "Let's kill him, and the inheritance will be ours." So they threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. What then will the owner of the vineyard do to them? He will come and kill those tenants and give the vineyard to others. When the people heard this, they said, "God forbid." Jesus looked directly at them and asked, "Then what is the meaning of that which is written? The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Everyone who falls on that stone will be broken to pieces. Anyone on whom it falls will be crushed." The teachers of the law and the chief priests looked for a way to arrest him immediately because they knew he had spoken this parable against them. But they were afraid of the people. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Bible is full of shocking stories. And these are the stories, of course, that you usually don't hear in Sunday school. For example, you can take even one of the most well-known stories in all the Bible, by believers and non-believers alike, the story of David and Goliath. Everybody knows that one, right? Everybody knows how this young boy, David, knocked down that big, bad, giant Goliath with a rock and a sling. But for most people, that's all they know. And even in some Sunday school lessons, that's where the story ends. Most people don't know that that young boy, David, then ran up to the giant, took the giant's own sword, and lopped off his head. A little shocking. Or you take a story from the book of Judges. A man named Jephthah, one of the judges of Israel. He prayed that the Lord would give him a victory in battle. And he said, "If you do, Lord, I will sacrifice to you whatever comes out and greets me from my home." And the Lord gave him that victory. And no doubt Jephthah thought he was going to be seeing some rooster or sheep or ram or goat or maybe even a bull. But lo and behold, it's his only daughter. And he keeps his vow. A little shocking. A story at the end of the book of Judges, where the Benjamites rebel in wickedness, and all of Israel rises up against them, and they beat down the tribe of Benjamin. They destroy their towns, their cities, they kill many of their people, including most of their women, so that the men who are left are distraught because they feel that this tribe is going to disappear from existence. They have no more wives. And the rest of the tribes of Israel have taken a vow not to give any of their daughters to the tribe of Benjamin for their wives. And so they tell him, "You know, why don't you go up to Shiloh, hide in the bushes, and when the young maidens come out during the festival, everybody rush out, grab one, grab her, and take her back home to be your wife." Kidnapping young women to be your wife. That was their solution. It's a little shocking. And of course, then there are all of the times when the Israelites were brought to enter into the promised land, and God told them, "When you get in there, be my hammer of vengeance on these unbelieving nations. And put to death, put to the sword every man, woman, child, their animals, their cattle, everything." It's shocking stories like that, shocking statements like that, that lead Bible haters to say, "What kind of God is this?" That lead them to disrespect, to disregard, to ignore God's word and say, "How could God say this? How could God allow this and command this? How could God desire something like this?" And biblical scholars will look at that, and some will say, well, that's because the Old Testament, well, things were a bit different there. They had a different idea of God back then, but in the New Testament, that changed. No, that's not true. All the Bible is written by God. And all the Bible contains shocking stories, shocking truths. Yes, we may find a few more of those in the Old Testament, but they are still there in the New Testament. Case in point, the Gospel for today. Did you hear that when it was being read? Yes, it's a parable. It's a story that Jesus told in order to teach a spiritual point. But it was still shocking. It was still unsettling. We saw that by the reaction of the people who heard it. God forbid, they said. That's what we want to look at this morning, this shocking story that Jesus told. And as we consider these words, my simple question to you is, what in that parable knocks your socks off the most? What in this parable is the most shocking truth of all? Let's find that out together. To be honest, the parable, it doesn't start off too shockingly, does it? We heard Jesus say, a man planted a vineyard and rented it to some farmers and went away for a long time. Pretty ordinary there. And if we look at the Gospels of Matthew and Mark, we get a few more details about this parable that Luke happens to leave out for us. We see just to the extent that this man built his vineyard, he didn't acquire it, he didn't purchase it, he didn't stumble into it. No, he built it up with his own bare hands. He cleared the field of the trees and the rocks within. He used those rocks to build a wall around this vineyard. He dug a wine press for the harvest. He even built a watchtower so that what was within this vineyard would stay within this vineyard. This was a vineyard that lacked for nothing. It had everything. Everything was provided for it. Everything that was needed. And then the owner of the vineyard found some workers to take care of the vineyard, to help produce the crop of the vineyard while he went away for a few months. But he was confident that come fall, he would enjoy the fruit of the harvest. God had planted a vineyard. He had planted his people, his word, his love, his truth, his promises in the choice land of Israel. All that God said he would do for Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, that he would give this land to their descendants, that he would be their God, that he would bless them with more children than there were grains of sand on the seashore, that he would bless all nations on the earth through their family. God did all of that in this place and in this people. And then God asked them to be faithful to him, to trust his promises, and to obey his commands. And he gave them workers in this field to help produce that crop. Those farmers, they were the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the chief priests, the scribes, the teachers of the law. These men who were graciously, or who enjoyed this gracious gift of the vineyard that God had given to them, that the people enjoyed as being part of that vineyard as well. But what was their response to that grace of God? Jesus said, at harvest time, he sent a servant to the tenants so they would give him some of the fruit of the vineyard. But the tenants beat him up and sent him away empty-handed. He sent another servant, but that one they also beat and treated shamefully and sent away empty-handed. He sent still a third, and they wounded him and threw him out. The farmers proved themselves to be pretty lousy tenants, refusing to give to the owner what was owed him. And that probably sounds a little shocking, doesn't it? Why would they do that? How could they act that way? But while it's unpleasant, while it's not nice, it's not terribly shocking. Especially if you know your Old Testament history. Because that's what God did. God sent servants to the vineyard. He sent his prophets to his people again and again and again. And the people of Jerusalem, the people of Judah, the people of Israel, they acted just like those farmers did. When God sent them Elijah, he was persecuted. When God sent them Jeremiah, he was beaten and imprisoned. When God sent them Isaiah, it's believed that he was perhaps sawn in half. And most recently, John the Baptist was beheaded. Jesus had even, not long before this, offered a lament for the city of Jerusalem. He said, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those who are sent to you." This is what you do. And this is how you respond to God's goodness, to God's love, to God's mercy, to his promise of salvation through a Savior, to his forgiveness and his grace, to this bountiful land flowing with milk and honey. This is what you do. When you go your own way, you don't like it when somebody comes and tells you to turn around. Sad and unfortunate, but probably not the most shocking thing in this parable. Now, with the servant or the farmers acting like that, mistreating the servants the way they did, that owner, it probably would have been expected that he would come back himself to deal with these tenants, that he would perhaps attack his own vineyard, leveling it if necessary, burning it to the ground if he had to get to these rebellious tenants. That might have been expected. But that's not what he did. Oh, he said, "What shall I do? I will send my son, whom I love. Perhaps they will respect him." But when the tenants saw him, they talked the matter over. "This is the heir," they said. "Let's kill him, and the inheritance will be ours." So they threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. A couple more shocking things there. But first of all, it's the grace of God and how he responds to the rejection and the rebellion of his people. He does so by sending his son, whom he loves, who pleases him perfectly with his perfect life and obedience. But along with that, connected with that, is the truth that Jesus knows what's going to happen to him. As he's telling this parable, he knows what's in store for him as the son that the owner sent. And of course he does. He's God. He knows all things. But here he is laying out in detail the events of the next few days for these Jewish leaders. And Jesus told this parable on Tuesday of Holy Week. That meant within 72 hours, he was going to be standing before the chief priests with many of these same men around him. And the chief priest would ask, "I charge you under oath by the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God." And Jesus would say, "Yes, I am. I am the Son the Father sent. I am the Son the Father thought that you would respect." And their response would be to say, "Let's get rid of him. Let's get this guy out of the vineyard so that we can run things and do things the way we want." And that's what they did. They took him out of Jerusalem and they killed him on that hill of Golgotha. What was the owner's response? "What then will the owner of the vineyard do to them?" Jesus asked. "He will come and kill those tenants and give the vineyard to others." Did Jesus just say that? It felt a little strange reading these words before as part of the gospel lesson and then closing with the gospel of the Lord. Because the gospel means good news. And it's hard to hear Jesus say he will come and kill them and give the vineyard to others and say this is the good news. It's hard to believe that Jesus is the one saying these words. And they are shocking. Because we hear the people there themselves say those words. "God forbid. May this never be." The people understood what Jesus was telling them. They got the gist of it. That how could anybody reject the Son like this? And those Pharisees, those chief priests, those leaders of the people, they got the gist of it too. They knew Jesus was talking about them. Jesus said, if this isn't true, if this isn't the way it's going to happen, then what is the meaning of that passage? The stone the builders have rejected has become the capstone. And the Jewish leaders, they were looking to build their own beautiful building. And they thought that they could build it on their own. They thought they could build it on themselves, their own works. They had no use for this common, misshapen stone of Jesus. So they rejected him. They tossed him out. But Jesus said, if this is the way it's going to go down, then know how it finally ends. You can reject me. You can push me aside. You can neglect me and forget me. But I am the stone that you will trip over and break into pieces. You can neglect me. You can forget me. You can ignore me. You can deny me. But I am the stone that will fall on you and you will be crushed. Either way, it doesn't matter. In the end, I am the one that remains, and those who reject me do not. I don't know how many times I read this lesson last week as I was studying. Every time I did, though, I was shocked by what I read. I was shocked at the starkness and boldness of Jesus' words, but he had to be bold. Because he was speaking to people who in just a few days' time were going to be pushing for his own execution. But I was equally shocked by the grace of God that even now, in this last week, he is still calling to his people. He is still calling them to repent. He's telling them, it doesn't have to be this way. You don't have to do this. Calling them to produce fruit in God's vineyard. Both equally shocking. And yet still not the most shocking, at least not to me. Now perhaps this is a point in a sermon where I would ask, can we be like those farmers? Or maybe I would even say, we are farmers, and not the bump 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 guy in the commercials. And we certainly can. We can be like those farmers. We can take this little vineyard that God has given to us, this harvest field of Northdale, and make it our own personal playground. We can withhold the good news of God from the next generation so that they don't know about the love of Jesus. We can be greedy and selfish and use our time and our abilities for ourselves. We can take our offerings and use them and turn them to ourselves, to our own pleasures, our own enjoyment, and not for the praise of God. We can stubbornly reject God's love and forgiveness and stubbornly refuse to love and forgive others. We can reject God's word and instead believe that the Bible just can't all be true, not all of it. Especially those parts that I don't like or that don't make me feel good. We can reject Christ and his sacrifice, thinking that our sins really aren't that bad, that we didn't need all of this by him. We can do those things. We can be like those farmers. And then if I said that, I guess that might be shocking. That might be shocking to us if we are completely oblivious to the arrogance of our own sin, just like the Pharisees and those chief priests and elders were. It might be shocking to us if we have no idea who we are, if we have no idea what we are capable of, if we have no idea what we deserve for our sins. But we do know, don't we? If you read your Bible, if you study your Bible, if you come to church, you do know. And if you're coming to church for the first time, if you're just starting out, it won't take you long either, and you will know. You will know how easy it is for us to ignore God. You will know how easy it is for us to disregard God's call to repentance, to ignore God's call to produce fruit, to be just like those farmers. And if that's the way we are, then we deserve to hear those same words from Jesus, our Savior. God should come and kill us and give the vineyard to others. That would be shocking. But we do know that. That's why we confess our sins at the beginning of worship. That's why, as we lay our heads down on our pillows at night, we bring before God all our sins, all our mistakes, all our failures, and even the ones we can't remember. And we seek His forgiveness based on the blood of Jesus. We do that because we do know. Because we don't want to be like those farmers. And friends, that is what is the most shocking thing of all. And most of this parable, Jesus isn't talking about you and me. In this parable, much of what Jesus says, He isn't thinking about you when He has these words in mind about these wicked tenants. Oh, to be sure, we are in this parable. Just not very much of it. It was there at the end, if you have your service folder open. There at the end, just that little phrase when Jesus said, "And He will give the vineyard to others." Brothers and sisters, we are the others. We are the others that Jesus has done just that. He has given us that vineyard. And that's something that Paul speaks about in his letter to the Romans in chapter 11. He's writing to these Gentiles who have brought into God's family, who have been made part of the family of Abraham, the line of Abraham through faith, true children of Abraham through faith. God says that from this tree that was the Jewish people, His chosen people, branches have been broken off and new branches have been grafted in. This is how He put it. Some of the branches have been broken off, and you, though a wild olive shoot, have been grafted in among the others and now share in the nourishing sap from the olive root. You are a wild shoot who has been grafted into this tree, into the vine of Christ. You have been grafted into the family of Abraham. You have been grafted into the family, the line of the promise. God has planted you in His vineyard. That is what is most shocking. That at your baptism, God took a lost and condemned creature and washed your sin away with the blood of Jesus through water and the Word. He then filled you with the Holy Spirit and put on you the robe of Jesus' perfect and holy life as your very own. And He wrote His name on your head, on your heart, and said, "You are mine. You belong to me." What's shocking is that now we get to receive the fruit of the vine, and with it, Jesus' own blood shed for our forgiveness. What's shocking is that we have not tossed out Jesus as the cornerstone, but rather, by God's grace, have been built upon Him, as Paul tells us in Ephesians chapter 2. "Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people, and also members of His household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus Himself as the chief cornerstone." What's shocking is this. We have been made heirs of the vineyard. And we didn't have to figure out how to get it away from the Son. We didn't have to plot and scheme how to kill the Son in order to get it. No, the Son gave up His own life so that He could give it to us. He sacrificed Himself on the cross so that He could make us heirs along with Him. The most shocking thing is that right now, we live where we do not belong, and we receive what we do not deserve, all because of the incredible love and mercy of our God. The love and mercy of God that shines brightest during this dark season of Lent, as we see Jesus open His arms in love to us, extending them on the cross for your sins and mine, for each and every one of you, and for me. That is a love so shocking that we are not left to say, "God forbid," as the Jews did. No, we can only say, "God, we praise." That is a love so shocking that it does not leave us stunned and paralyzed and immobilized. It is a love so shocking that it jolts us into action because we know that the Father is not done with His vineyard. He is still expecting fruit. He is still sending His servants to this little vineyard of Northdale. And He is still expecting to enjoy the sweet wine from its harvest. brothers and sisters, may this grace of God, upon shocking grace of God, only fill you with joy upon shocking joy, knowing that not only does the Lord always keep us safely planted in His vineyard, but He also makes us willing workers in His field. God grant that this always and ever be so, to His grace, or by His grace, and to His glory, until the harvest comes.